Now we begin the program with the war of words between the Labour Party and the Governing All Progressives Congress, APC, over statements credited to the vice presidential candidate of Labour Party, Dirty Baba Ahmed, calling on the Chief Justice of Nigeria, Justice Olukayode Ariwoola, not to swear in President-elect Bola Ahmed Tinubu. According to Dirty, Tinubu did not meet the constitutional requirements to become Nigeria's president as he didn't get the required 25% in the FCT to be declared president-elect by INEC. The Independent National Electoral Commission had in March declared Tinubu as the winner of the February 25 presidential election. Tinubu, the candidate of the APC, scored 8,794,000 votes and secured the 25% threshold of total votes in 30 states of the Federation, but failed to have the threshold in votes cast in the Federal Capital Territory. The LP and PDP have now filed petitions in court challenging INEC's declaration of Tinubu as president-elect. Well, joining us in the studio is a member of the Labour Party Presidential Campaign Council. He is actually the spokesperson, one of the spokesperson of the LP, Kenneth Okonkwo. He's also a lawyer and politician. Now, Arise News had also extended invitation to the All Progressives Congress through Festus Keyamo and, of course, one of the party's members in the media directorate of the APC campaign, Niyi, Akinsiju, who all promised that they will be made available, especially Niyi, Akinsiju, that he'll be made available right here. And Keyamo declined to be on the program, but we'll just have to go ahead with one of the parties that we have here. So good to have you, Kenneth Okonkwo, join us on the program.
Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me, and thank you viewers at home for tuning in.
Yes, APC says you're overheating the polity, and that some of your supporters have been calling for an interim government, while your vice presidential candidate, Dirty Baba Ahmed, is asking the CJN not to swear in President-elect Bola Ahmed Tinubu. And the controversy continues despite your filing a case at the Presidential Election Petitions Tribunal. And the governing party saying that if you're in court, why are you making, quote, incendiary statements here and there? How would you react to the APC?
Good. First of all, Professor Mahmood Yakubu promised Nigerians that he is going to organize the presidential election and the gubernatorial and the legislative elections, and that the results will be uploaded in real time from the polling unit via the BVAS. He did not do it, and he has acknowledged he did not. According to him, there were flaws. Now, the APC, before the election, warned all the non-APC members who were not going to vote for APC not to come out to vote. It is open. They warned the non-indigents. As a matter of fact, they even invoked Oro Festival to make sure they frustrated everybody. It's on record. And then they were not heating up the polity. And after the election, and after the open robbery that took place, a man rose up. His name is Peter Obi, and said, "Let there be calm. I am going to take my grievances through the courts." It's on record. And then suddenly, some spin doctors announced saying he is the one who is overheating the polity. Is there no level to lies and hypocrisy? And they were the people that told him, if you don't like what is happening, go to court. And he went to court. And yet, he's the one overheating the polity. I want to tell you, the people that are overheating the polity, they are Professor Mahmood Yakubu. They are APC, because right there in front of Nigerians, the APC presidential candidate made a treasonable statement. He said power is not served a la carte, like breakfast. You have to fight for it at all costs. You have to grab it at all costs. You have to snatch it at all costs, and you have to run away with it at all costs. That is the treasonable felony. That is overheating the system. How many of them had petitioned the DSS to take him on that? And you know what? On the election day, they actually executed that his order to the latter. Women were brutalized. Non-indigents were brutalized. the security agencies were there.
That was during the governorship election.
Now and the presidential.
Now, in the presidential election, Dati Baba Ahmed is saying that it will be the end of democracy if Bola Ahmed Tinubu is sworn in as president on May 29. And the APC is crying foul. I mean, Keamo had issued statements, including today, saying that, look, going ahead to make these statements are terrible. And what other plans does LP have? And they are saying that if you came third, why are you so sure that some of your prayers will be answered? He has written to the DSS. Yet we've also had what looks like incendiary comments coming from Femi Fanikaede and even Keamo himself. How do you react to all of this, which a lot of Nigerians who voted for you, voted for Labour Party, PDP and APC are perplexed all about, that the politics just seems overheated?
First of all, I'm surprised that you're still taking those army of people seriously. Just go out and read their tweets. If you don't like what they are saying, just keep quiet. They will soon change.
How do you mean?
Oh, just go to the contradictory statements they make, even about themselves. I know of one of them that is telling you that if your father is Yoruba and your mother is Igbo, you are Igbo. And that person never raised any male child except through an Igbo woman. How do you listen to such people? Let me tell you, because I want to dive into what Baba Ahmed said. We are in court. And paragraph 20 of our petition says, Bola Tinubu was at the time of election not qualified to be president. And the next one is that his election was invalid by reason of corrupt practices and non-compliance with Electoral Act 2022. And the last one was that he was not validly elected by the majority of the lawful votes cast at the election. Now, a man who has this position and is in court, what do you want him to say? Can he approbate and reprobate? He's simply telling you that in his own opinion, which he's entitled to by Section 38, Section 39 of the Nigerian Constitution, which gave him freedom of thought, freedom of expression, freedom of belief to express his thought the way he wants. And he was in the studio saying it. Not in the forest with guns. He was not a rebel. He was simply expressing his thoughts. He has not told anybody to carry gun. He said, in my opinion, if you are not supposed to swear this person in, and that is why we're in court.
So why don't you allow the court process to be concluded before making some of these statements? Because that's what the other party is saying, that then, you can't be in the court and be on the streets at the same time.
Then why did you invite him to tell him what is he going to court for? You are the one who invited him. You asked the question and he gave you the answer. So, what do we say?
All right, I will ask you to just hold on because I've been told that Niyi Akinsiju of the APC is here with us. And so we'll go on the short break, and when we come back, we'll have both gentlemen stay with us. Welcome back from the break. You're still watching This Week on Arise News. And of course, we're still talking about some of the top issues between the governing All Progressives Congress and the Labour Party. And of course, joining us now is a member of the APC Presidential Campaign Media Directorate, Niyi Akinsiju. And of course, I still have with me here Kenneth Okonkwo, who is a lawyer, politician, and spokesman of the Labour Party Presidential Campaign Council too. Thank you so much, Niyi, for joining us. Yeah. Now, let's talk about this statement that you've been issuing, including the petition by Festus Keamo, that the Labour Party is in court and that some of the comments coming from some of its leaders, including the vice presidential candidate, is incendiary. And as a result of that, you think that the polity has been overheated and that the calls for an interim government for Tinubu not to be sworn in are not supposed to be discussions at this moment.
If we start from that interim government thing, actually that's irresponsible as far as we are concerned. But going forward, other forms of interventions that are being made at the level of our directorate is just to call for moderation. Moderation and the fact that we have gone into an election. The election result had been made public. Our candidates, who is the president-elect, had even made overtures to the opposition, those who had lost, that he is willing to do a government of inclusivity. And of course,
he said a government of national competence.
Yes, that is include. It was initially that he was ready to do business with everybody. Then, 2 or 3 days after he made that public announcement, opposition losers, headed to the court, you know. And after a while, he had to come out with a principled position to say, no, this is what, it is not as if he was pandering as a result of a blackmail. This is what he desires going forward, you know. And since then, we've been hearing, you've gone to court, you issue press statements, you grant interviews, and you keep virtually blackmailing anybody that was not with you. And we thought that is not appropriate.
But they said that they were taking the cue from what happened during the governorship election, especially in Lagos. The accusation is that Tinubu was quiet when all sorts of violence were happening and all of that, only for him to call for people to remain calm after the elections had happened.
What sort of violence did we record in Anambra during the presidential election? What manners of suppression of voters did we record in Enugu during the presidential election? And even during the presidential, during the gubernatorial election, this thing is not about seeking fault. For us, we've been in government, and we have seen how government runs. And the important thing for us is to have a peaceful atmosphere. And we believe in the judiciary. People said they were going to seek justice in the court. Please, go seek justice in the court. And I am even saying that INEC had done innovation, had introduced innovation, upscaled their technology, that had even made seeking justice at the level of the courts and tribunal much easier, you know, through the Beavers and the IREV. So when you have all these things in place, it's not like before. If you were in Nigeria, 1999, 2003, 2007, 2011, when you could get ballot papers, thumbprint them, stuff them into a ballot box, and they'll be counted without anybody being accountable for it.
All right.
Now, the case is different now. So when it is different, why don't we allow for the judicial process to end, you know, to be concluded, and then we know who exactly is at fault here?
Okay, so is there no room for reconciliation among all political leaders to allow the judicial process to prevail? What do you make, Kenneth Okonkwo, about these allegations of incitement by Festus Keyamo? Because I'm seeing a statement written by them. He says, on many occasions after the declaration of Tinubu as the winner of the election, his public speeches and utterances have centered on reconciliation, forgiveness, and a greater vision of Nigeria. Do you believe that statement?
The statement is flat lie. And I'm sorry to say, just like Niyi has just made his well-known bombastic lies. He said Enugu, he said Anambra, he didn't mention one example. MC Oluomo told anybody who does not want to vote for APC not to come near the polling unit. And he fulfilled the threat. In Lagos, a lady was blinded and she still went back to vote.
Presidential election. She's not fully blinded.
Good,
actually.
Fully. And she still went back to vote. Lagos. And the emails we are told not to come out in Lagos openly. It is there. Let him cite one. I'm from Enugu. I voted in Enugu. Let him cite one or two specific incidents. Time has gone for all those, throwing up statistics that are non-existent. And now, I told you, after the election, you know what Bola Tinubu said? The Igbos came to Lagos when they were 12 years. And now they are not voting for us. This is supposed to be conciliatory. I said, if there is anybody that should be taken to the DSS, the person is Bola Ahmed Tinubu. And I told you before he came that he came out openly to tell his followers, power is not served a la carte. Then what is democracy? If power is not served a la carte, the whole idea of democracy is peaceful transition of power from one person to the other. And you're telling your people, fight for it at all costs. Grab it at all costs. Snatch it at all costs.
But that statement was made as early as last year.
No,
Before the presidential
that
election, during the Chatham House,
you know,
statement. When Bola Ahmed Tinubu made that statement, a lot of people expected that the security services would also caution him on that statement. But that didn't happen. So why did you rush to the DSS without quoting Tinubu's statement?
It was more than 20 years old. That power is not served a la carte is the motivational speech. The content of the most motivational speech that Bola Tinubu usually presents to his followers, when especially they are going into election, and the whole idea is to galvanize
people and to mobilize the supporters to say that if you have to get this power, you must reach out. You must overextend yourself. It is not about sleeping in the house.
It doesn't include taking up arms or stopping people from voting or voter suppression.
I'm saying the first time I heard this particular statement from him was in 2002 when he was preparing for 2003 election. And it was to his supporters to say power is not served a la carte, is that you do not sit back in a democracy and wait for fight for power to be delivered unto you. If that is just the meaning of it. But you see, when people have their own consciousness of lying, of twisting issues, that is what you get. For every statement you make, people with such kind of vile consciousness tend to twist this thing.
Yeah, but I said some of your party leaders are also doing that. Like people like Femi Fanikaide on Twitter. Going very personal, going very tribal, including people like Festus Keyamo, including people like Bayo Onanuga and all of that. Shouldn't Bola Ahmed Tinubu be cautioning his
issue that had been at the front burners, our spokesperson at issue releases. And to that release, you can hold them for it. It's not just about bystanders comments or pedestrian comments. You have read Festus Keyamo's release now. You can, of course, rationalize and analyze contextually what he meant by what he's saying. So when you have heard somebody saying something, power is not served a la carte, that every member, every follower of Tinubu had imbibed and internalized since 2003 and 2002, and is that becoming an issue in 2023, you know, by opposition that had lost power, lost election?
He's saying that you have lost election.
He's talking about somebody lying in Enugu. While he's talking about one woman that was hit in Lagos.
Yes.
Okay, all right. But we also know
a particular man
was pursued out of the polling units.
For but wanting to vote the
APC.
Let me give you an example, a particular man.
I do not know it's there in the social media.
All right, let's come back to you and the Labour Party. Now, your vice presidential candidate is saying that Tinubu should not be sworn in on May 29, or it will be the end of democracy. If he's not sworn in, there's no vacuum in power. What will happen, after May 29?
Good, thank you very much. And let me tell you who lost. Because P2B did not only win, he humiliated them.
Well, according to our next figures, he came
third. Hold on, he was the only person that made 25% in the whole 6 geopolitical zones, including the FCT. He won him in his principal's home state, won him in the national chairman of APC state, he won him in the DG of APC state, he won him everywhere. And you what? Even in FCT.
His which is a controversial make 25%.
So what I'm telling you is that he not only won them, he humiliated them.
But according to INEC figures, he came third. Good. Now, you're saying
according to INEC figures.
Yes. Now, what I'm interested in is finding out what should happen after on May 29. May 29.
Let us go to what Baba Ahmed said.
Also set
let us
straight.
Say what
because
Baba Ahmed said.
Some people.
Baba Ahmed.
Just hold on.
I have the floor.
Let's hear from him. Quickly, as we try to round off the conversation.
Like I told you, the paragraph 20 of our petition. Good. We are in court. Baba Ahmed was called. Why are you in court? He said, we have a petition. And this is our grounds. If you don't believe in your ground, why are you going to court? If I believe
that... that same interview, he said he didn't believe in the judicial process. Now, what should happen after May 29?
No, he did not say so. I have my doubts about the judicial process. That was what he was saying. No, he said it that if the Supreme Court gives judgment, he will accept. But that does not mean...
Yeah, but he also said that this same Supreme Court made somebody who came forth as the governor of Imo State. And as such, the Supreme Court seems to be losing grasp of the people's will.
Are you aware of the Zamfara judgment that declared the whole APC votes, wasted votes, and made people to come first overnight? That's what we're saying. That the votes that his principal had are wasted votes. Because at the time of election, he was not qualified. And let me break it down.
The court
that's what I'm saying. Let me break it down.
Very quickly as we
round off this. He was not qualified because he chose to nominate a vice presidential candidate who, at the time he nominated him as vice presidential candidate, was having the nomination of Borno North senatorial.
The Central PDP went to court on that, and just on Friday, that case was dismissed.
You would allow me to finish. Which Friday? We're talking about double nomination. And they couldn't have gone to that case because we're talking about tribunal. And let me tell you, Section 35 of the Electoral Act is very clear. A double nomination makes the nomination void. And that means the candidacy of his principal is void. Again, the candidate did not win 25% in the FCT. And he said you cannot declare him if he did not win. And then again, in the process of election, as brief as I can be.
Very quickly, so that he will respond.
Having wasted votes, we are no longer third. We are first. Mm. We won in Rivers, we won in Taraba, we won in by our own petition,
okay,
which we believe in.
Okay, so now,
Tinubu is not the president elect.
People. Okay. That is why. So who is the president elect? Who is the president elect?
If you ask to say, I will tell you the president elect by our petition.
These people are suffering from delusion.
Okay, now they are saying that president elect Bola Ahmed Tinubu should not be sworn in on May 29th, what should happen on that day? Yes, Dirty Baba Ahmed said so. So what do we do on that day?
He said if he's sworn in, we have sworn in an unconstitutional government.
It is part of the delusion that they are suffering from. I am praying that they should quickly go get the attention of a psychiatrist. Seriously.
Is that not so hard on them? Because they are raising constitutional matters.
I am here. Who is talking more coherently?
Please, now. Is it not also obvious that there is a problem with their fixation on reality if they cannot accept the fact that they didn't even have up to 25% in up to 18 states?
According to the declaration of INEC.
You know? Well, I don't know if Labour Party has INEC now.
Well, they are claiming that based on their own tabulation, they had more than Atiku and Tinubu.
Based on our own tabulation, based on INEC's tabulation, we have more than 25% in more than 30 states of the federation.
Except the FCT. What of that of the FCT that you're talking
about? FCC is just another state. It is just another state by the constitution.
Right, let's come in.
The FCT, by the constitutional definition of it, is not bigger, stronger, are more important than any other state in Nigeria.
All right, gentlemen, I'm afraid we just have to start rounding off. Very quickly, okay. I'll give you 30 seconds
issue.
Each
Let's talk
to round off before
FCT.
We go.
Now, the Constitution is very clear. Before you are declared the winner, you have to have the majority vote and 25% in at least 2/3 of the states and the FCT. The words of the Constitution is very clear. FCT is not a state in Nigeria.
Well, there's a Supreme Court judgment.
No, he said in Section 299, he said in interpreting the Constitution.
30 minutes.
In interpreting the Constitution, the FCT should be treated as a state. But let me tell you, in Section 299, he said the president of Nigeria is the governor.
Yes.
Good. Is there any governor that will be declared governor in his state without winning 2/3 of the 25% in 2/3 of the local government? And then you're telling the governor of FCT that is not supposed to have 25%. Where did you get that from? The Constitution is very clear. If you're a citizen of FCT, you want to be discriminated against. No, the person that should be your governor should have 25% of your consent before being your governor.
Well, these are issues that are left for the court. So your own 30 seconds, your own 30 seconds before you go. Kenneth Okonkwo, let's just have
given
very quickly as we allow you.
It is simple. The FCT, from the day it was created, we had always in common parlance referred to it as Nigeria's 36 states and the FCT.
Good.
From the day it had been
created. So and that the and now is the question. That's where the argument lies. Just hold on.
The and principally created a conjunction to it. So that because at that time it was not enjoying the favor of being a full-fledged state. So therefore, if you are doing something across states, you will have to consider it as part of the 36 states.
Okay, so but with the new Supreme Court judgment, you are saying that it's now a state.
It's It should be treated as a state, not as a super state.
Well, the these are some of the issues that, I mean, we dominate the presidential election petitions tribunal. I've been trying to avoid going into those issues so that we don't go into the legal grounds. But of course, gentlemen,
I am not a lawyer.
You're a lawyer and you understand some of the issues. Our own appeal as journalists is for you to ensure that the rhetoric that's going out there doesn't lead to violence. Of course, there can't be vacuum in power. So by May 29th, something must happen. Therefore, the courts and then for the authorities to decide. But we must thank you so much, gentlemen.
That is why you just have to advise them, APC.
We must thank you, gentlemen.
Nigerians will dance. Nigerians will celebrate the inauguration of Bola Ahmed Tinubu.
Akinsiju is a member of the Media Campaign Directorate of the APC Presidential Campaign Council. And Kenneth Okonkwo is the spokesman of the Labour Party Presidential Campaign Council. The debate continues on this issue, but of course, the courts will eventually be the final decider. I must thank you, gentlemen, for being on the program.